Good morning. So I'll be speaking to you today about what's new in Caddy and how its features might spark new ideas in your mind and help you scale your applications. But first, if you've not heard of Caddy, I'd like to give you a quick overview of what it is and why you might use it. So in short, Caddy is a general purpose web server. You might have heard of Apache and Nginx. You can think of Caddy as an alternative to those. Matt Holt wrote Caddy and initially released it in 2015. Matt gave a talk here at last year's API platform conference about how Caddy fits into the architecture of your PHP apps. The web server, it sits between clients like your web browser and your website's backend. For example, your marketing website, it has JavaScript and CSS files. Caddy serves those with its static file server. Other requests for dynamic content, like your API, they get passed to PHP FPM, which is what actually runs your PHP code. Caddy can act as a reverse proxy, which is to send the request to another HTTP server and have it write the response. And Caddy will pipe that back to the client. An API platform, this is used to proxy to your Next.js app. You can also proxy WebSocket connections, for example, from a Node.js server or a React PHP server. At its core, Caddy is a configuration platform. It reads in a config, parses it, loads it, and then it starts a server that does what the config asks it to do. Every feature in Caddy is a module, and the standard distribution of Caddy comes with lots of modules built in to cover most of what you might want to do with it. The API platform distribution ships with Caddy. Kevin chose to use Caddy because he'd be able to integrate Mercure and Vulcain into Caddy as plugins, which greatly simplify the deployment stack. It means that there's less individual pieces to the deployment. And Caddy has an admin API built in, which allows for making changes to the config while it's running. You can also pull metrics from it, like Prometheus metrics, and more. Most people's favorite reason for using Caddy is automatic HTTPS. What it does is it automatically gets a TLS certificate for your domain, keeps it renewed, and you don't need to do anything. It's all built in. So why would you use Caddy instead of another web server? So one reason is Caddy is written in Go. Go is a memory-safe language, which makes it immune to all kinds of patterns of security vulnerabilities. For example, other servers are typically written in C, and C is not memory safe, so there's more risk of vulnerabilities. Go is easy to learn, so it's easy to contribute to Go projects if you want to write plugins or help fix a bug. And it's statically compiled, so you don't have any dependencies outside of the program itself to worry about. It's a single binary. Caddy prides itself in having good defaults, and this is important to making sure that your apps are secure without you having to change a bunch of config options. It also means you have a smaller config file, which is easier to read, which also means it's easier to make config changes and to learn how to use it. Caddy has competitive performance with other web servers. Under the hood, we use Go's standard HTTP stack. And it's fast enough for Google, so it should be fast enough for you. Keep in mind that your web server is almost never the bottleneck to your app. Usually the bottleneck will be your PHP code and the database queries it makes. I mention that because we get asked about benchmark scores all the time, but it doesn't usually make sense to compare web server performance against one another. That said, Tyler Langlois has posted some extensive benchmarks yesterday comparing Caddy with Nginx if you want a recent example of some benchmarks. So here's an example of a Caddy file for a typical PHP app. You can see it's pretty simple. You tell Caddy the domain name you want to serve, so example.com, where your app's web root is, so in this case it's /serve/public, which should be where your index.php file lives. Then you tell it how to connect to your PHP FPM service. For example, here it might be a Docker container named PHP FPM, listening on port 9000. You'll also need to enable a file server to serve your JavaScript, CSS, images, etc. And finally, we'll enable an encoder for gzip compression to save some bandwidth. But really, Caddy's native config language is actually JSON. Caddy has a concept of config adapters. So the Caddy file is one type of adapter, and which takes your Caddy file config and turns it into a JSON config that Caddy actually runs with. The JSON config in this example is pretty long, and I truncated it because it wouldn't fit in the slides. But that's because the Caddy file hides a lot of complexity. The PHP fastcgi directive, it's a shortcut that expands to a lot of boilerplate config to make your PHP apps work. Most people just use the Caddy file, but some power users, they write scripts to generate JSON configs dynamically, and they can load it in with Caddy's admin API. So as I mentioned earlier, many users' favorite feature in Caddy is automatic HTTPS. Caddy is HTTPS by default. That means you don't need to explicitly configure it to serve HTTPS. Remember in the Caddy file we just saw, we didn't have HTTPS //:// in front of the domain. We just told Caddy the domain we want to serve, and Caddy will set it up if it can. It'll obtain and renew a TLS certificate for each of your domains using the ACME protocol, fetching one from Let's Encrypt or Zero SSL. And those are certificate authorities that implement the ACME standard. Caddy has a gold standard ACME client implementation and has the most robust and reliable implementation out there right now. And it can recover from a certificate being revoked. Or for example, if Let's Encrypt has problems, it can fall back to Zero SSL. Caddy can scale vertically, so you can have tens of thousands of domains or more, and it can scale horizontally, so you can run multiple instances of Caddy, and they can coordinate in a cluster. So that means one Caddy instance can start the issuance process, and then another can finish it up, as long as they both share the same underlying storage. Caddy also has a PKI app, which lets it act as its own CA. So it can self-sign certificates for you, so you can test your app with HTTPS in localhost during development. A feature unique to Caddy is on-demand TLS, and what this does is allow you to issue certificates for domains you don't control. You might have customers who want to use their own domain to serve your white-labeled app for branding purposes, and with Caddy you can do that easily. So, with all that said, who am I and why am I talking to you? My name is Francis Lavoie, and I'm here from Ottawa, and it's my first time here in Europe. I had fun traveling for the past week or so ahead of the conference. I first landed in London, then I visited Belgium and the Netherlands, and finally ended up back here in Lille. Je suis franco-ontarien. Many people assume that all francophones in Canada are from Quebec, but I'm from Northern Ontario, where over a quarter of the population there is francophone. I studied computer science at Carleton University. Then I started my career as a PHP developer, full stack. And now I work at Vectorface. We're a small company, and I've been there for 4 years. But unfortunately, we don't use API platform because the company was founded in 2004, 18 years ago. And we mainly work on maintaining a large PHP app with an in-house framework. So my history with a Caddy project started in late 2016. I was building an on-premises installed app, and I needed a way to easily deploy it with HTTPS built in, because it didn't make sense to ask our customers to buy TLS certificates. So I ended up finding Caddy, and it was perfect for what I needed. I opened up some issues on GitHub to get some help, and that went great. I started to understand pretty well how Caddy worked, and I had some ideas, so I opened some feature requests, and I spent some time in the community forums answering questions. So Matt liked that, so he sent me a DM asking me if I'd like to be more involved with a project, and he invited me to be a contributor. And I was pretty excited about that, so I did. I mostly did issue triage for a while, but then I gained more confidence from reading the code, understanding how it worked. I fixed some simple bugs, I was part of the discussions about new features, and I helped with design decisions. So fast forward to 2020. Of course, the pandemic hit us, but that did mean that I suddenly had a lot more free time working from home. So I decided to spend it on Caddy. Matt had been working on a complete rewrite of Caddy, and he released it in May of 2020 as Caddy V2. Since then, I've become the number two contributor on GitHub. And I visit the community forums almost every day to give community support. I do it for fun because I really like the project. Still though, I don't really consider myself a Go developer. I'm more of a Caddy developer because having built a Go app of my own, I've just contributed to Caddy into some of its plugins. So now to the meat of my talk. So now I'll talk about the new features we've built in Caddy during this past year. So first I'll talk about request matchers. So for some context, in Caddy, routes are a middleware pipeline. So in each in the routes you have handlers, and handlers are things that do things in your in Caddy. And usually a handler is paired with a matcher. So a matcher is a condition that decides whether the handler should run. So if the matcher matches, the handler runs. If it doesn't, it gets skipped and it goes to the next handler. So there's all kinds of matchers. Here's just a few of them. So there's the most commonly there's the path matcher, which lets you match on a specific path pattern, or you can match with a regular expression, or match part of the query or a header. You can match if a file exists on disk. But the most interesting one we'll talk about here is the expression matcher. So the expression matcher uses the common expression language, or cell, and it allows you to write Boolean expressions to match your requests, mainly using placeholders. So here in yellow, you have placeholders in brackets. So for example, this one, it matches whether a method starts with the letter P, so that would match post, put, patch. And the host matches localhost. So this is what, in the API platform Caddy file, you have a config like this. So this is a matcher that matches whether a request should be passed to your Next.js app. So here you can see it matches the accept header, whether it has the text/HTML MIME type, and it matches a bunch of complex path patterns to see if it should go there or not. So this is a bit hard to read, and we thought we could maybe improve on this. So another concept in the matchers is we have named matchers. So a named matcher here is at WebSockets. It's essentially a grouping of multiple matchers as one condition. So here we're matching whether a request is a WebSocket initial request. So we can tell by looking at the connection and upgrade headers, and if those have the values we expect, then it's a WebSocket connection. So we can pair it with the reverse proxy handler, and if it matches, we send it to that upstream, and if it doesn't, then we skip that handler and go on to the next one. Another example of a matcher is we can match whether the error status code we got was a 500 error, and if it is, we do a static response. So the problem with this was that named matchers, they can't do complex Boolean logic. So the reason is because we don't have the concept of parentheses, and we don't have explicit Boolean ands and ors, because those are implicit in our syntax. But it's possible to abuse the not matcher with De Morgan's laws. So this is a bit of a technical concept, but essentially you can the not can be transitive to the other side. So for example, not A or B becomes, wait, my screen went blank. Oh, there it's back. So not A or B becomes not A and not B. So for example, if you wanted to match the path foo or method post, then that's not a real config for here, but the way you would have to do it is with this longer not path foo and not method post. But that's really confusing and hard to read. So we wanted to find a better way to do this. And also expression matchers, another issue is that they can only operate on placeholders inside of their expressions. So you'd have to use placeholders like this in your expressions to match things. So the solution was now we provide all the built-in request matchers that we have in Caddy as cell functions. So here's what the expression can look like. So we have a method. A method matcher or a query matcher or the path matcher, and we can use parentheses and ands and ors to do something really complicated. So this required a bunch of parser trickery in cell to make this work, because when we recognize a matcher name, we then need to parse the arguments, and the arguments depend on the matcher name, and they're all different. So you can see the query matcher, it takes a key and a key value pair. So this, we had to parse that ahead of time. So that, and this is parsed when you first load your config, and it's very performant. But yeah, it was very complicated code to figure out. But once we had it, it works really well. And this was contributed by Tristan Swadel, who works at Google. And he's the author of the cell itself. And he's been helping us a lot with getting it integrated with Caddy. And it's really nice now. So this is what it looked like before. And after our changes, this is what the matcher can look like now. So it's a lot easier to read now with the built-in matchers. So you can see that we're matching the accept header with a key value pair. And all the path matching is uses our built-in path matcher. It's a lot easier to read. So next, I'll talk about reverse proxy features. And I want to give a reminder that all of this also applies to the PHP FastCGI directive, because the PHP FastCGI directive is actually a shortcut for reverse proxy with the FastCGI transport. So almost all the config in the reverse proxy also applies to the FastCGI directive. So first, about upstreams. So the reverse proxy, it supports multiple upstreams, so you can have load balancing and failover. So here we have an example with three upstreams and enabling the round robin load balancing policy. So what this does is Caddy will first pick the one with the IP address 1, then 2, then 3, then go back to 1, then 2, then 3, and so on. And that way you can spread the load across multiple upstreams. So the problem we had was this configuration is static. You have to put it in your config, and it's just hard-coded there. And changes to it require config reload. Config reloads are fast in Caddy, but we wanted to find a better way so that every single request could choose a different kind of upstream. But we had some really bad options for doing dynamic upstreams at the time. Each of them had significant limitations. So. And it wasn't extensible, so people couldn't plug in their own functionality to do things. So we introduced a dynamic upstreams interface, and this is pluggable. So here we have the dynamic option and using the SRV module. So this allows you to use DNS SRV to do DNS lookup to get your list of upstreams that you proxy to. And this happens on every request. Or you can optionally enable caching for it if you want, so that it only happens every few seconds. You can even enable retries, so if it fails for some reason, then it'll retry it. And this was implemented by Matt Holt, and there was a lot of community help as well for reviewing and testing, and that was great. And this functionality was sponsored by Stripe, and that's really nice, because having corporate sponsors that contribute means that it helps assure the project's future. So next, here's a couple use cases for dynamic upstreams. So for example, you might have a customer who wants their data to live on their own server because they don't want you to handle their data along with everyone else's and risk leaking data across different tenants. So what you could do in Caddy is you could write a plugin to choose the upstream by the request domain name. So with a dynamic upstream module, you could do this, and you could choose a specific upstream or multiple upstreams for a specific customer. So they each get their own app instances, and that could be something you could do. Also, you could enable auto-scaling for your backend app instances. So you could have service discovery with console. So if your demand increases, you can have Caddy proxy to the automatically started instances. So next, I'll talk about reverse proxy response handlers. So response handlers are sometimes you want to rehandle the request after the proxy response. So what you can do is you can match the response by a status or response header. For example, you can catch error status codes like 502 or 504 from your proxy, and then serve a static error page to your clients. Or you could implement XXL redirect functionality. So what this does is it lets you serve protected files, for example, user uploads, and have your backend decide whether it should display those files or not. So it's they're not visible publicly. Only your backend as gets to decide whether they should be shown or not. But this functionality existed early on in Caddy, but it was fundamentally broken. And that was because of a lack of testing and a lack of users of the feature, because it was only available in JSON config. But most of our users use the Caddy file. So eventually we added Caddy file support. We got more users. We also implemented response matcher syntax so that you could configure it in your Caddy file to match responses. And that really revealed a bunch of the issues we had, and we were able to fix them, and now it works well. So I want to note that we don't know everything, and it's really important that users reach out to us and tell us what their use cases are and how they use Caddy and how they would like to use Caddy so that we can find the right way to solve problems. So next I'll talk about forward auth. So forward auth is a concept where you can send the request that you received to some authentication gateway. So if you don't want to implement authentication in your own app and you want another service to delegate it to another service, then you can use this. So what it does is it decides whether the user is authenticated by checking the request headers. Typically, it'll look at the cookie, so you'll have an authentication or a session cookie or an API token in your headers. So if you're authenticated, then the request gets handled and handling continues. But if not, then the user gets redirected to your login page. So this functionality was requested years ago, but we didn't know how to support it exactly because we didn't have the infrastructure in place to make it work. But suddenly, once we had response handlers working and in good shape, we could look into it. So while we were looking into it, we found Authelia, which is an open source auth server and gateway. And we looked at their GitHub issues, and we found that there's actually many users that requested Caddy support with it. But we didn't actually hear about it until we started looking into it. So we reached out, and we got in contact with James Elliott, who is one of the maintainers of Authelia. And he helped us test and design Caddy's forward auth functionality. So this is what the config ended up looking like. So first, you have a site, auth.example.com, which serves your actual auth gateway itself. So this will serve Authelia. And then you can serve your own app, so app1.example.com. So we're using the forward auth directive. And what this does is requests will first get sent to Authelia, but at a specific URL, /URL/verify, which is the endpoint where Authelia will take in the request and look at the headers and check if it's authenticated or not. And if it is authenticated, then we can copy the headers from the response from Authelia back onto the original request that came in to Caddy, and then that gets passed through to your actual app. So for example, the remote user header could then, you'll see that in your app if the user is authenticated, and you can then check if the user exists, and if not, create it, I don't know, whatever. And if the user is not authenticated, then it will stop at the forward auth, and Authelia will trigger a redirect to the user back to the login page. So the forward auth directive is actually a shortcut for a reverse proxy with a handle response. So this is the expanded form. Essentially, like I said, it's just a shortcut. So this is what it expands to in reality. And you can see it always has the method get, it always does a rewrite, it always adds a couple extra headers to the request that goes to Authelia, and then it has a handle response when the status is good, which copies the request headers. So next I'll talk about a few other small improvements in Caddy, and I had to cut some of them for time, but here's the more important ones. So first I'll talk about logging security. So we had a problem in Caddy where Caddy's access logs may contain auth information and from headers. And that's not good because a lot of companies have policies to not log sensitive information, and for good reason. So what we ended up doing is we stopped logging authentication headers by default. So we have a certain list of headers that we always hide from logs, but we have an opt-in option that you can turn on to show those in your logs if you do need it for debugging purposes. And we also added some logging filters for sanitizing logs. And that was contributed by Kevin, and thanks to him. So you can filter specific your query and your log, so you can filter the cookie, so you can hide only a specific cookie but show the rest. You could also hash a specific value, so it will, if the value changes, then the hash changes too, but it's a way to still see if the value changes, but without being able to see what the value is. So next, we have a templates directive in Caddy, and that, what it does is it executes the response body as a template. So this is kind of like Twig, which you might know, but it's built into Caddy. So for example, here's a basic template. So if there's a user, hello user is not a username. Else, hello guest. So Caddy's website and documentation are actually built with this templating functionality. And we also have a markdown function built in, so you can render your own markdown with Caddy without having to pre-render it to HTML or anything like that. It's all dynamically done on each request. So you can have a static site with sprinkled in dynamic content, and that's really powerful for different ways of building sites. So the improvement that was made here is that plugins can now provide new template functions. So the possibilities are really endless. You can do whatever you want with the templates. If you want to build an entire website and you need to add some extra functionality to it, you can do that. And that was contributed by Tyler Kropp. So next I'll talk about upcoming features in Caddy. So we actually just released the beta for Caddy v2.6 last week, the first beta. And we're really excited about it because it's probably going to be the biggest release for Caddy since the original V2. There's so many new features. So I'll talk to you about a few key ones here. So we're finally enabling HTTP3 by default. Caddy had experimental quick and then HTTP3 support for years. But we were waiting for HTTP3 to get finally standardized. And it finally did in June as RFC 9114. In API platform deployments, this was already enabled for you, so you didn't need to worry about it. But now it's time for Caddy to turn it on by default. So all users of Caddy will have this on by default unless they want to turn it off. So we also made a few small adjustments to it for performance. So now when there's not a lot of traffic, it'll perform even better than before. So this means that you might get some errors at load time if you still have the config for the experimental HTTP3 mode. So you'll need to remove that. And also big thanks to Martin Seaman, who maintains the Quick Go library, which is what we use in Caddy to provide HTTP3 support. And that's because Go itself doesn't have support for HTTP3 yet. And we're still waiting to see if they'll work on this at some point. But for now, the community has to build their own functionality, and Martin has taken the lead on that, and it's working really well. So next, we're introducing an event system in Caddy. This is big, and we've been talking about this for a long time, but it took a lot of time and discussion to really land on a specific design to do it right. So we were actually inspired, or I was inspired by a Symfony event dispatcher, because I use Symfony myself sometimes. Essentially, of course, an event system. Caddy will emit events when it does something interesting. So when a certificate is issued or renewed, you'll get an event and you can handle it and do something with it. So you can copy the certificate file somewhere else for another app that might need it. So for example, you might be running a mail server and your mail server needs to encrypt its connections with TLS, but you want to use Caddy's best-in-class certificate management to manage that. But that was difficult because of Caddy's file structure and whatnot. But now it's a lot easier, so you can copy your files elsewhere and use it. For another example, you can, when a proxy upstream becomes unhealthy, you can check that with health checks in Caddy. Then you can now get an event to see that an upstream is unhealthy. So you can trigger an alert in your alert system to find out, and then you can look into it. So we're marking this as experimental in Caddy v2.6. That's because the design is not necessarily final, but we're getting close. Next, we introduced virtual file systems in Caddy. So for context, the file server directive, of course, it serves static files. Until now, it only served with your operating system's file system APIs. But Go recently added a new io/fs package, and this is a unified interface for file system. So in PHP, you might know a fly system. It's a bit like that. So plugins can now provide support for alternate file systems. So for example, you could serve your files directly from Amazon S3 through Caddy or some other blob storage, or you could write an adapter to serve files like images directly from your database. Or this is the one we're most excited about. You can we're working on our build system to make it so you can embed your static site into Caddy's binary at build time. So that means that you could have your entire static website plus an HTTP server all in one file, and then you put that on your server, you run it, and there you go, your entire website all in one file. And that's really exciting, and we're hoping to improve our build system to make that really easy to do. Next, we now have good support for HTTP 103 early hints. So this is a feature that allows your server to tell clients about some resources they should load early. So for example, some JavaScript or CSS, or you know, Vulcain. So it's essentially that. And this replaces HTTP2 server push. That was a newer feature, and 103 early hints is actually a really old spec. But the thing is, Chrome actually decided they no longer want to support server push. So Kevin and Vulcain, they decided they need to look into it. So Kevin actually contributed a patch to the Go standard library itself to make it possible to support 103 early hints. And Caddy is inheriting that support, and we also made a small patch to make it work even better in Caddy. And this will be around in the next version. And yeah, so users of Vulcain should probably get this transparently. So nearing the end of my talk. So before closing up, I'd like to ask that you ask your company to sponsor Caddy. So Matt Holt, he's a full-time open source developer, and most of his time is spent on Caddy. I have a full-time job, but he doesn't, and sponsorships are the main source of his income. So if you want to see Caddy continue to thrive, and you appreciate the features it has, then that's the best way to assure Caddy's future. Sponsoring can get you priority support, or you can ask to have certain features prioritized if they're important to your business. So thank you for listening. I hope some of the features I talked about might give you some ideas for building cool new features in your apps.